the Distinguished Speaker Series at the College of Engineering and Computer Science. And today we are very fortunate and honored to have invited Dr. Chris Welty from the IBM Watson Research Center in New York. Okay. And his talk will be focused into inside the mind of Watson. Okay. And Dr. Welty is an internationally well-known researcher in many areas, particularly in the area of knowledge representation. And I will invite Dr. Amesias to give a detailed introduction of Dr. Welty.
I don't think most of the audience needs much of a detailed introduction. I thought of getting Chris here when I saw his presentation at the Worldwide Conference. And it's, you know, many of you novices know that's a key conference for us where we also start to publish and go. And so Chris gave a keynote at the recent Worldwide Conference. And you also may know that he has been involved in semantic technology for some time. Before that, he was on the formal side. He was at Vassar College and RPI. For 14 years, he went to IBM. One specific thing you may be also aware of is that he was chairing the RIF, Rule Interchange, related W3C group, which has recommendation now that you might be, that you are aware of. He also worked on the formal side of ontology earlier on, now works a lot with this deep QA team at IBM Almaden, and which is part of the Watson team with a lot of natural language processing and such. This particular talk, as you know, will be a more general talk focused on Watson and the Jeopardy challenge that it won. And just yesterday I passed along that video that Chris himself had put on the former winner of Jeopardy, what he talked about. So you guys have a lot of context. This afternoon at 3 o'clock, we meet again in the Brandenburg conference room to have more of an interactive session on the natural language processing for healthcare, for medical use, Watson, and things of that nature. Chris, we are so delighted to have you here. I know you have had long association with RPI. Our group here essentially are the major groups in semantic web and related areas in the US. And we'd like to get a little thank you with them, but welcome here.
Thank you. Right, since you mentioned my World Wide Web talk, I'll tell you a funny story that the night it was in Lyon, France. And the night before, I had one of these raw meat dishes at a restaurant. There was very tasty, but about 20 minutes into my talk, my stomach just went, I don't know exactly what it was, but it felt like there was a rock running through my digestive tract. I'm really interested to see what I look like during about 5 minutes of that talk where I was in excruciating pain. And just tried to keep talking. I think I was sweating and really was very uncomfortable. I wanted to just say, excuse me, can I take a 5 minute break? But I survived. Hopefully that won't happen this time.
It didn't show on the video.
It didn't. All right, good. This might have an acting background. Both my parents were actors. Show must go on. All right, so this is a sort of a higher level talk on Watson, but I'll normally when I've given this talk, you know, once or twice or 100 times before, so it's fine to interrupt and ask questions at any point you want. So just an overview of where we were. You know, we the group that I was in was a natural language processing group for a long time. I joined it in 2001 and added a more explicit semantic and logic flavor to things, but they had been doing question answering, open domain question answering, which is a field of computer science that starts more, has its roots more in information retrieval, and took a very very search-like approach to answering natural language questions, which is an important distinction to make because, as I'll say later, there's a pretty important and fundamental misconception that people have when they hear about Watson, how it may work. So our group was already working on natural language open domain question answering before the Jeopardy challenge was presented to us, and I should stress, if you've seen some of the videos, we admit that it wasn't our idea to do this, it was someone else's idea, and they came to us because we were the question answering experts. The idea of open domain question answering is to give precise answers to questions where precise here means not a document that you have to read, which is what we're familiar with in web search. When you ask a question, you get something short and precise back that you would accept as an answer to the question. If the question is, what's the tallest mountain in the world, you don't read a document that discusses tall mountains, you get Mount Everest. That's a precise answer. Confidences turned out to be really crucial in being able to play the game, and I think is a very important aspect of the novelty of the work that we did, which I'll come back to. Consumable justification, so explaining where the answer came from, is critically important for the technology, especially as we on the Watson team and a lot of other people move into areas like healthcare or legal or financial computing. You need to know why the machine believes what it believes. And the system that we had in place, which wasn't that great before we took on the Jeopardy challenge, took about 2 hours to answer a question, and that was a couple minutes too slow for an exciting game show. So, you know, we needed to work on that as well. And as I hope you all know, we showed in a televised match that we succeeded in building something that was capable of doing these things. I'm going to assume you know what Jeopardy is. I give this presentation internationally a lot where they've never heard of it. So, as a result of Watson, an idea that several people on the team, including myself, had sort of became a label that IBM decided it wanted to attach itself to, which is cognitive computing. I didn't make up the words, and certainly other people throughout the past 30 years have used the term to mean something different. So I'm going to come back to this sort of theme and explain what we mean by cognitive computing here. Generally, that there are a new class of problems that computer science is traditionally not considered part of the base set of computer science problems, which we're now calling cognitive computing problems, which IBM is now calling cognitive computing problems. A lot of the roots of these kinds of problems are from artificial intelligence, which has always had a fairly uncomfortable relationship with other more traditional parts of computer science. But now it's clear that the most important and the most widely used problems that computers are being asked to solve are in this category of problems for which there are no precise solutions. And what we need are approximations. And systems don't get debugged, they get improved over time. You know, they behave correctly in some cases and incorrectly in some cases, and our goal is to just over time improve the way they work and the response that they give. So we're not solving the traveling salesman problem anymore. We're solving problems like understanding natural language, understanding speech, translating English into Russian or back. These are cognitive computing problems. So I want to stress here, I'm not claiming we invented this, but it was a realization that certainly people on our team came to after Watson that this was the prevalent form of computing today. And web search is probably the most pervasive example of that. So if you think of web search, no one claims it's perfect. But we would not be able to use the web without it. And over time, it just continues to get better. And I'll describe methodologies that we used in developing Watson that I think are very common and in other companies and are certainly becoming common in computer science education, but it's not everywhere. So the four tenets of cognitive computing are learning and improving. So systems that, as I said, get better over time. There's no idea, no expectation that they'll ever be perfect at any task, at any of these cognitive computing tasks, but that we will continue to improve them over time. That they are somehow matched to problems that people are solving and interact with them in a way that they, you know, supplements their ability to process, in particular, huge amounts of information. So we're talking about throwing computers at problems that people traditionally did but no longer can do because there's way more information than they can process and understand. I come from, you know, I work for a company that sells computer hardware, and so this is a good part of it too, that you need to have a lot of computing hardware to solve these problems. And then finally, there's the interface aspect here, that the machine, in order to augment human cognition, needs to be able to interact with humans in a seamless way. That includes using our language instead of the computer's language, but also includes embedding processing in an interface in a seamless way that people are sort of interacting with the machine without really knowing or caring that they're providing information as part of the process. So, I mean, obvious examples of cognitive computing are web search, searching for images, which is today a just horrendous problem on the web, and certainly within companies is even worse, because you don't have the support from link analysis that you get at least with web search. Searching for events, I think we can say is a basically unsolved problem. Social computing is just presenting to us more and more examples of uses that people are going to have for computing devices, and also new ways that, because there's not enough information out there, more information is being generated. And of course, Watson and natural language processing in general. So I want to talk a little bit about why Jeopardy was hard, and I also want to point out to you that, in case you didn't realize it, I mean, you all live here in the United States, but you may not have grown up with Jeopardy like I did. It's been on television since the 60s. If you went to school in the United States at some point in your life, through school, you were exposed to the Jeopardy format. Everyone sort of had classes where information you were supposed to memorize was presented by some teacher in a fun way, and almost always it was a Jeopardy-like way. It's considered by Americans culturally to be sort of the one game show that isn't a stupid game show. It's considered fairly intelligent. And I know I'm pretty smart and knowledgeable, and I have a hard time answering the questions that they ask. So they're not asking dumb questions. For the machine, it was an incredibly hard problem as well. So here's two examples of real Jeopardy questions. If you're looking at the wainscoting, you're looking at in this direction. Answer. Anyone? Down. Looking down. Wainscoting is this wooden paneling that's on the bottom half of the wall. The first person mentioned by name in The Man in the Iron Mask is this hero of a previous book by the same author.
What is the Three Musketeers?
Incorrect.
No. Same author.
That's the book. Look at the question. D'Artagnan is the answer. Who is the hero of the Three Musketeers? A very complicated question. So for people, the hard part here is really knowing all this stuff. The breadth of the Jeopardy game show, the questions that they ask, the breadth is quite large. Okay, it could be biology, medicine, history, a lot of entertainment and cultural information too. And so having this breadth of knowledge is a huge challenge for people. For a machine, that's trivial. We put Wikipedia on a disk drive and we've got answers somewhere there to 99% of Jeopardy questions. For machines, the problem is the questions are in English, okay, and machines don't understand English. So for us, that was the challenge. And when Watson presents an answer with a confidence, that confidence is its confidence that it understood the question, not its confidence that the answer is correct. Okay. For a person, if you ask them to estimate their confidence, first of all, don't ever ask a person that because you'll only get one of three answers. I think so, 90%, which means 100%. And I don't know. For a machine, when it says 90%, it means 1 out of 10 times I'll be wrong about that answer, right? 90% to a machine doesn't mean absolutely correct. And we've had this experience with educated people that they see answers Watson gives with 90% confidence and say that are wrong, and they say, wait a minute, it's 90% confident. Yes, it's wrong 1 out of 10 times. And so for people, their confidence is not ever has to do with how well they understood the question. It's how well they think, how sure they are of their answer. And for the machine, it's subtly different. For cognitive computing systems, and for Watson in particular, one of the critical things and an important paradigm shift in essentially engineering these kinds of computer systems as compared to the way educated in computer science in the early 80s, we were taught, it's all about the metrics. This idea that you're continuously improving over time implies that there's a way of telling that you got better. So it's usually a metric that you can conveniently, when the metric is one that you can run quickly and often and repeat without people constantly inspecting the system. So for us, the metric was the one I'm going to show you, which was a measurement of the confidence of the machine's answers versus the essentially the number of questions you get right. So we felt this was critical for the Jeopardy test. So on the x-axis you have, the assumption here is you have a set of questions, and the x-axis is what percent of those questions you answer. And the y-axis is the percent of the questions that you answer, you get correct. And so now that cloud there at the top is our plot of human expert performance, that is people who've won a game of Jeopardy. So for every game, we plotted the percent of the questions, and there's 61 questions in most games if every question is revealed. So for every game, for the winner of that game, what percent of the questions did that person answer? That's the x-axis. The y-axis is what percent of the ones they answered they got correct. And so you can see average expert human performance centers there around 50% answered and 90% So winners of the show, on average, are answering half the questions in the game and getting 90% of them right. And that was essentially where we wanted to be. And the red dots there are the games of Ken Jennings, who was one of the two people we played against. He is the winningest player in Jeopardy history. He won 74 games in a row. I think second place is 14 or something like that. So it's just... He's a machine, they would say, and you can see his dots are significantly shifted. His centrist is answering about 65 to 70% of the questions at about 95% accuracy. And the brown line is our system that we had running, which competed at this sort of academic evaluation. On question answering, and that's the performance of the system we had when we began this project. And the way we calculated that line was we took a set of questions, in this case 2,000 questions. We knew the answer to each question, although the system obviously didn't know the answer. And what we did was we took its 2,000 answers and we ranked them by confidence. And then as we move from the far right of that graph, where it's forced to answer every question, as we move to the left, we're only taking out the low confidence answers. And so ideally, if confidence is being meaningfully computed, you'd expect that line to go up with like a slope of -1 all the way to the top at some point. If you were doing perfect confidence estimation, as you drop questions off the bottom, you're only losing wrong answers if your confidence estimation is perfect. So if the machine knows when it gives a wrong answer that it's wrong, and if it knows when it gives a right answer then it's right, that would be your ideal situation. And so the brown line there says really sucky confidence estimation combined with a really sucky question answer. And so we basically said at the beginning of the project that we were going to go from where we were, which was just less than second grade level question answering ability, up into the winners, what we call the winners cloud here. So the first thing we did was re-architect our system from the ground up. And I just want to explain the general flow. I'm going to go into a little bit more detail about how this works, and we can dive deeper into it in later meetings if you're interested. Starts out, as you would suspect, with question. There's a whole bunch of these background sources in there, which are primarily text. Databases, mainly from linked data on the semantic web. I'll talk a little bit more about that. But primarily our sources are text. Wikipedia, other encyclopedias, a variety of really reference sources for looking up answers. Our assumption was that our sources were factual. We did not use the web. So a question comes in, it gets analyzed in a variety of different ways. It's parsed, we recognize named entities, we recognize dates, and we recognize verbs, and so forth. We then take keywords, essentially, out of the question with some language modeling ability to, for example, expand synonyms, and do just traditional, regular information retrieval keyword search. We get back a bunch of documents from that keyword search, and then we analyze each of those documents and we pull out snippets, which we call passages, which are typically 1 to 2 sentences long, that score well on the search criteria, which is, again, just really counting keywords plus some language model. Then we extract out of those passages what we call candidate answers. These are things that might be answers. These are things that we're actually going to look at and try to determine for each one if it is an answer. So we call that candidate answer generation, or more generally, hypothesis generation. So from that, we get a list of several hundred answer-like snippets of text. But at this point, those snippets are just strings. Nothing in the system has figured out what it means. They're just somehow correlated with words in the question. And then the heavy lifting part of Watson kicks in, and for each one of those candidate answers, most of them you would consider ridiculous as an answer to the question, but Watson considers them all according to these evidence scoring algorithms. And that's where the real heart of the system is. There's about 150 of these algorithms that essentially take the question and one of these candidate answers and tries to figure out, each one tries to prove in 150 different ways that this is the answer to the question. And it gives it a score.
What is the basis of those 150?
So there's no basis other than they are supposed to produce a score that is either larger if according to that algorithm the answer is correct.
Is there some kind of broad classification of the coverage of those?
I'll talk a little bit more about them, but you can imagine, so one simple one is engram. So what is the engram count between this candidate answer and individual words in the question? How often do I have an engram, from that has this word in it and words in the question? So what is sort of the web-based correlation between these words? And then we have more meaningful ones. I'll talk a little bit more about some of the kinds of evidence that we gather. There are two general categories of answer scoring. Shallow answer scoring, which doesn't do any more search. Like, for example, engrams. Engrams is a database that you can download that Google makes available, and it just has for you know, sequences of 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8 words, how often those words appear together in a sentence on web.doc. It just counts of that. And that can provide some signal. If words appear frequently together, they're correlated, they probably, if your question words are highly correlated with another word that's not in the question, that gives you some evidence that this may be a meaningful answer. But it's not the only thing you consider. That would be shallow answer scoring. Deep evidence scoring is when we actually do more search. So given this answer to the question, imagine you just, here's a candidate answer. I'm going to look at this question, I'm going to take the what is part out of the question and put the answer in. And I'm going to turn the question into a statement with this candidate answer in it. So if your question is what's the tallest mountain in the world, I change that with the answer Mount McKinley, which is the tallest mountain in the United States, and I turn the question into Mount McKinley is the tallest mountain in the world. And now I go search for that. And if I find that sentence in my corpus, that's pretty strong evidence that Mount McKinley is the right answer. And then finally, we do some very complicated confidence merges. So we have hundreds of candidate answers. Each one has hundreds of scores, evidence scores associated with it. Those need to be combined so that I can rank. You know, one answer may have really good Engram score and a terrible search score or something like that. I need to be able to combine those in an intelligent way to rank the answers and also produce a confidence. And I also need to account for the fact that different candidate answers may vary at the lexical level, like I may have mt.mckinley for Mount McKinley, I may have m-o-u-n-t McKinley. They're different strings, but they mean the same thing. That's not a trivial thing for a machine to determine, and so we need to have some way of approximating that as well, and knowing that different evidence scores may arise from different lexicalizations of an answer, and those scores need to be merged and combined in a productive way.
Chris, are the techniques similar to boosting kind of stuff, or is there something
similar to boosting? So here's an example. I'll go through the pipeline that I just mentioned with a real example. In 1894, C.W. Post created his warm cereal drink Postum in this Michigan city. I should have changed it to Ohio. I apologize. Anyone know the answer? That's the first time. Okay, so here's what we do in question analysis. We look at the question, we get the keywords out. That's, you know, that's a 20-year-old technology, still useful today. We recognize the lexical answer type. We do this based mainly on the syntax. So we recognize that most questions do indicate what the type of the answer is that the asker is expecting. And certainly this was very strongly the case in Jeopardy. And so we don't really know at this stage what Michigan, it's misspelled there, we don't really know at this stage what that means, but we know that syntactically this string is being used as the type. So we know that our answer should somehow be considered a Michigan city. I'll talk a little more about that later. We know that 1894 is a date, but at this stage we don't really know anything more about it than that. We know that there's some kind of relation, create relation, between post and cereal drink, which you can see is sort of not helpful in this question, but it's something that we can recognize. So then we go and we take the keywords, we search the background corpus, generate a bunch of documents. Out of the documents, one simple way of taking those documents and generating candidate answers is just extracting the noun phrases. So if we took every noun phrase out of the documents that search returned and made each one a candidate answer, you can imagine a lot of them are going to be just garbage. But among them will be the right answer, and the job of the evidence scoring is to trickle those more obvious answers up towards the top. So here are some candidate answers that might come out of that unstructured search. And as I said, there's two kinds of scoring now. So these are the candidate answers here, this list on the bottom left. And I'm going to score those in two ways. One are the shallow ways, which only really consider the answer and the question itself, and maybe some very quick resource like an Engram database or something like that. So very rapid types of scoring, and then the deep scoring, which actually does a second round of search. And this second round of search is, computationally, this is the most expensive part of the system, because for every candidate answer, and there's hundreds of them, we're doing another search. And now, I mean, this goes to Amit's question a little bit, and I'll go into some more detail. We then compute in 150 different scores for each answer. So some of the scores have to do with, for example, the relationship, if I artificially construct a statement out of the question like I described before, how is the word that I'm using related to the other parts of the question? Does it fit syntactically? Does it fit probabilistically? Do I have evidence from language models that this word, you know, just goes here? You know, does the statement parse? Does the answer correlate with other words? Would you expect to see that there, and so forth, based on large-scale language data? Taxonomic data, which is the primary place that we use linked data from the semantic web in judging, sort of making use of this lexical answer type that I said there, Michigan City. So to what degree can I consider each one of these answers a city? And then in the spatial dimension, to what degree can I consider these Michigan cities? And so you can see there, taxonomically, Battle Creek and Grand Rapids are both cities. I mean, New York would be just as much of a city here. But then in the spatial dimension is where we actually bring in more semantic data, semantic knowledge about, we use geonames there, so we know that if New York were an answer, that it's not a Michigan city, but that Battle Creek and Grand Rapids are. And then the temporal dimension here is fairly shallow, because that's all we needed, and Jeopardy rarely ever gives you anything more than a year. And so we just need to know, is there any evidence at all? And we just use correlation here between this year, correlation with a sort of fuzzy matching boundary between this year and anything in the question. And so from these different scores, we would expect more or less most of the time the right answer to emerge at the top. I can dive into a little bit more detail here about, I'm not sure this gives you very much more information. One of the most important and really the area of Watson that we consider now the heart of the system is what we call passage scoring. And passage scoring sort of starts with this idea that I mentioned before, that if we can take an answer, put it back into the question, and then try to find if there's a statement in our background sources that says that, that we have an answer. And of course, it's never going to say it exactly the way the question said it, but so we need to compute sort of what we call an alignment, passage alignment. So we want to know the degree to which any particular passage that was retrieved corresponds to the question in a linguistic way. Yeah?
For the various features you've got, like in the last question, the Michigan, in that case, the spatial feature is relatively important. What percentage of those are likely to be important on a given question, and do you have anything in there that ranks the relative meaningfulness of each feature given what information you have?
We have, so the meaningfulness of each feature is just learned with the logistic regression, you know, perceptron. But we have a two-level perceptron here that does gather evidence from does what's called model selection, but it gathers features from question analysis, make the features different. So, for example, a question that has a year in it is going to be, the features are going to be ranked slightly differently than a question that doesn't. But those, for the model selection, the features are very shallow and based only on analyzing Jeopardy questions. Okay, so passage matching here is really a critical part of the system. This is where the most real natural language processing comes into play. This is the place where we're really trying to answer the question, does this 1895 in Battle Creek, Michigan, CW Post made the first postum a cereal beverage, does that align in a sense? Does that match the question? Is this answering the question? We usually say justifying. Is this a justifying passage? A justifying passage contains the right answer and explains why. And usually, how we know it explains why is because it somehow lines up with the terms used in the question. But we have to take into account the fact that different words may mean different things. So you can see this first passage here on the upper left of the passages, it uses the word beverage, and the question uses the word drink. So it's a cereal beverage in that passage and a warm cereal drink in the question. Okay, we have no problem. This is obviously answering the question to us. But for a machine, these are different strings. Okay, different strings, different things. This is not the answer to the question. You need to know that drink and beverage, at least here, mean more or less the same thing. You need to know that the word warm, it's not that important that you didn't match a warm. Okay, it's still answering the question. And again, we get that. And I was having this discussion with Ken Jennings, who some of you may have seen. I posted on Google Plus a link to his TED Talk. And he felt that, you know, there were some unfair things about the match, in particular the speed at which Watson is able to buzz. And I talked to him after the match, and I said, you know, well, we think it's unfair that you understand English. What we should do is give you the questions in a language you don't speak, and then see if you can get the right answer. And so these are actually incredibly hard problems, to be able to determine that a passage contains the answer. Now that we're working in the medical area, it's much harder. So this gives you a little bit more feel of what's going on inside this feature merging. So it's really a fairly simple idea from 80s, I don't know, 60s, I guess, in computer science, perceptron learning, where you're just, you know, given the fact that we have a lot of questions because, well, this is a feature of the web now. Fans of the show Jeopardy, and there's a lot of them, have recorded every game. They've transcribed it. Volunteers, not people who work for the show. This is fans of the show. And there is a website when you can go and you can find every question ever asked and every answer given and every correct answer. So that gave us a lot of data to train these models because we know what the right answer is supposed to be, and so we can, you know, for any given question, we can compute the degree to which a particular feature, which is a numerical score on an answer, correlates with being correct.
So would you say that in other domains like medical, maybe the right answer is not known authoritatively?
So this is, I think, for cognitive computing systems, one of the biggest challenges is this. I mean, programming has, in a sense, been replaced with generating ground truth. Because you need to do programs, features tend to be rather simple. But understanding how they get combined is very complicated. We want the machine to do that combination, but it needs ground truth to do that. And this is a really non-trivial problem.
Are these confidences probabilities, or are they just some arbitrary number?
So in the yellow there, those are numbers. And what the system needs to do by itself is scale them. So you can see clearly that there are numbers here that look like they're between 0 and 1 and look more like probabilities, but they're not. They're scores. And then you can see some scores, like the term matches, are just numbers. And so the system needs to understand how to combine these appropriately. Okay, and just sort of how the answers kind of merge through, you know, flow through the system, that's kind of useful. So here, I want to take an opportunity, now that you know how Watson works, and you all deeply understand it and could add new features to the system if asked, I want to correct this misconception. So a lot of people think that the way Watson works is it just knows, has a bunch of answers, and when it's given a question, it looks up the answer. That's what it's doing. Look, how many times I've heard people, especially people in the, not the popular press, but the scientific press say, how does Watson look up its answers? So what it's not doing is what people in NLP at the beginning of artificial intelligence, and continuing for about 40 years, believed language was going to be processed by machines, which was to essentially take human linguistic utterances and translate them into some sort of unambiguous semantic representation. It was almost always logic. It would therefore represent understanding of a question. It would read its background sources and understand them in the same way by representing what those background sources say in something like logic. And then the process of question answering would be simply query answering in a database system. And this is not how Watson works. It doesn't ever do this. Now, that doesn't mean we don't use semantics, but we use semantics in an entirely different way. We extract little pieces of semantics out of questions, the things that we can do with some kind of reliability. This thing, turning a question into a logical form like this, nobody can do that reliably. We don't know how to do that. It's never been done. It's been the utopian goal of natural language processing for 40 years, and no one ever succeeded at doing it.
But Woods talked about it extensively.
Who?
William Woods talked about it extensively.
He did, can't do it. A lot of people talked about it extensively, but nobody ever did it.
No, he said you should not do it.
Yes. Oh, he talked about not doing it. Yes, absolutely. And as time went on, more and more people started realizing that this was impossible. But one of the things they threw away with that realization was the semantic representations, and they're not useless. They just can't do this. What they can do are things like this. We know we have lots of information about a geographic location. And we can fairly, one of the biggest problems in exploiting large databases of background knowledge is just matching on the names. And if you go to Wikipedia, there are over 1,000 different things in Wikipedia that have the name China. The Chinese national volleyball team, the Chinese national badminton team, the country, the Senate, blah, 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 blah. A million different things that have the label China. So if you use the word China and try to look up, oh, what things in my database have that name? You're going to get 1,000 things. Which one do you use? That's not a trivial problem to solve. Actually, it's a very, very complicated problem to solve. But almost everyone who thinks about this for the first time ignores that and assumes, I'm just going to look up China. What are you talking about? I know what China is. But we can fairly reliably look up place names because there is enough context in most questions and in most passages to be able to say, I know I'm looking for a place name Michigan or a place name China. And I usually have enough information in my sources to help me disambiguate, at least down to a few choices. Dates are fairly easy, and using temporal information is something that we can do at a coarse grain fairly well, but at a fine grain, not very well. And as I was saying, type information. So this is, turns out to be an incredibly useful part of semantic processing that we use in Watson.
If you draw analogy to database query processing, where you, for example, use selectivity extensively, do you do that too here? For example, city here is very clearly an important thing about selectivity. If it's not within Michigan, then it just doesn't matter. Is that something that...
If you think about the architecture, it's only used in this hypothesis and evidence scoring stage.
But it's, the system is able to understand dynamically the type, most relevant type for that question and give it the highest priority.
I wouldn't say the highest priority. It gives it a high priority, you know, normalized statistically over a set of questions, how often it has been a useful piece of information, being able to match this to a type. I have a lot more detail I can give on the typing dimension of this. I'll go into a little more detail on the typing. So let me go into how Watson does work. So Here's a question, a real Jeopardy question. In May 1898, Portugal celebrated the 400th anniversary of this explorer's arrival in India. Does anyone know the answer? Vasco da Gama, correct? Here's two passages. One of them's a real passage. Oops. Okay, on 27th of May 1498, Vasco da Gama landed in Cabot Beach. The other one's a made-up example just to prove a point. In May, Gary arrived in India after he celebrated his anniversary in Portugal. So if you're using only keyword information, it should be clear to you. The blue words are the keyword matches to the question. So if you're just using regular old keyword search, you're gonna think that passage about Gary is your answer. You're gonna think Gary is the answer to the question. You don't really know what the keywords mean. You just know that they're there. The answer, the justifying passage there on the top right, has only one keyword in it. So what do you need in order to recognize that these two passages mean? Well, as we believe, what you don't need is this fully logical semantic representation, because in fact we don't know how to do this reliably. And even when we do it reliably, anyway, we don't know how to do it reliably. Let me leave it there. Okay. What you need to be able to do in order to answer this question, in order to recognize that passage justifies the answer, let's look at some of the things where it seems to mismatch, at least from a keyword level, it seems to mismatch the question. Okay, only one keyword in common. You need to be able to understand that something that was celebrated in 1898 as the 400th anniversary must have happened in 1498. So some simple date math. But in order to do that, the date math isn't the hard part. The hard part is recognizing that you need to do the date math and recognizing what the arguments to the mathematic expression are. We had a question, what is the number of legs in a dog plus the number of legs in a spider? Watson said, 200. Everyone laughed and said, oh, Watson can't even do math. Oh, no. Watson can do math better than anyone on Earth. But what Watson doesn't know is English. It didn't understand that was a math problem. And so that is the challenge. The computer can do its job fairly easily if it understands what the job is. And the challenge is recognizing when particular bit of something that's easy for a machine is necessary. So being able to recognize 400th anniversary of something in 1898 means 1498. Being able to understand, notice the question asks for arrival in, which is already sort of an unusual way of saying it. You would probably never say that yourself. And landed in the justifying passage. Again, no problem for us. It's obvious. You probably didn't even notice that difference. But for a machine, that's a big difference. They're different strings. Arrival in doesn't mean the same as landed in. You can't even say they're synonyms. But in this case, they serve the same purpose and they should match. You need to know that this is a legitimate paraphrase in this context. You need to know, and this is where we use structured information, you need to know that Cabot Beach is in India. Now, you may not even have known. I certainly didn't know that. And you need to know that Vasco da Gama is an explorer. And actually, you don't need to know all of these things. But you need to be able to match. You need to be able to match with the right answer more things than match with any of the wrong answers. And the more things that you do match, the more confidence you have that your answer is correct. And so what Watson's confidence really reflects is how much linguistic evidence it's gathered for a particular answer. So let me now, to answer Amit's question, let me talk a little bit more about the typing dimension. So this is the primary place, so we also use it in geospatial knowledge and temporal information, but those were less common in clues. Almost every, 85% of Jeopardy questions had type information in the question, and we were able to exploit it for helping to understand what good answers were versus bad answers. So the problem is really, if you think about the architecture now, we don't consider type information at all when we're generating candidate answers. We're just generating candidate answers from passages using some fairly very simple, very fast algorithms. Like, for example, one of them, not the only one, but one of them is to extract every noun phrase. So what the system that does typing is given is the word, the string, uninterpreted string from the question that indicates the type, and a candidate answer as a string, completely uninterpreted. And the job of the typing components, we call type coercion. We call it type coercion because what it's really trying to do is say, is there a way, do I have any evidence anywhere that says I can call this answer a whatever the type is? So in this case, for each answer, Tycor is saying, in this case, the question named after the 35th president in 2010, this facility saw more international air traffic than any other in North America. The answer is JFK Airport. And the type word in there is facility. Okay, this facility. So we're really good, over 90% accuracy in finding that type word correctly. So we're pretty good at saying, okay, facility. I'm looking for something that's a facility. The system does not assume that there's one and only one typing system in the world. But rather that language is fairly loose, and I might call almost anything a facility. I mean, I could call the bathroom a facility. But by some definition of facility, it's not, right? A facility in some ontologies is a big complex like an airport. Okay, so can I find any evidence that JFK is a facility? Well, this is a real, and also a nice example because there's obvious ambiguity in JFK. It's the name of a bridge, an airport, a highway, a college, a high school, a town, you know, whatever. There are a million things named JFK. If you want things named after you, be assassinated. It's a good way to go about it. But not just yet for me. I still have a few other things I want to do. So the first step in trying to answer this question, the question I'm trying to answer, this, and remember, we're doing this several hundred times per question. So this is just one candidate answer. It happens to be the right one. But we do this for every single candidate answer. First, look it up in various sources. We use linked data, we use WordNet, we use IMDb and Freebase and a variety of these other sources. We also use linguistic data, but the structured ones are very useful here. And so I'm going to look it up in my source. In this case, I'm looking it up in DBpedia. I find it has a URI, among others. I'm not going to talk about how the ambiguity is resolved, but let's just say that somehow in this context, this algorithm figured out that JFK, in this case, referred to that DBpedia URI. And now, what is fairly easy in most structured sources, I can just grab all the types. And one of them happens to be typed in the Yago, if you're familiar with Yago, which is mapped to WordNet, so I can get to the WordNet airport term here and say, one of the types of JFK in my sources is airport. I then go through an algorithm that takes this type word that we call the lexical answer type, or LAT, and tries to turn it, find a mention of it, find an entity corresponding to it in the structured source. And so I get to the facility term in, or synset in WordNet. And then I have to have the fourth component of the system is an algorithm for sort of comparing those two structured terms now, these are nodes in a graph, and compute the degree to which I believe they match. So in this case, since an airport in WordNet is a subclass of facility, I think I have a good match. And so you notice that each one of those four steps has a score. So I have about a 0.7 confidence in that candidate lookup. I have about a 0.9 confidence in the type lookup. And you know, essentially those four scores get combined by multiplying together to get the final score. So I have a sort of I'm going to say confidence, but it's not really a confidence at this stage. I have a 0.63 typing score. And in this case, for this answer, it was one of the better matched typing scores. But certainly, something less ambiguous like, you know, Wright-Patterson Air Force Base would have a very high score as a facility here. It doesn't mean it's the right answer. It just means I'm much more confident that it is a facility. Why? Because the name is less ambiguous. And so typing alone isn't going to get you answers. A lot of answers are of the right type. And every once in a while, a wrong answer isn't computed. It doesn't mean it's of the wrong type, but a lot of times, a wrong answer, not a lot of times, occasionally a right answer, we're not able to find any evidence that it's the right type. But still, we get it as the right answer. And then in some of the funnier examples of wrong answers that Watson gives, it gives answers that it knows are of the wrong type, but it thinks it has other evidence to justify it. And so this gets this whole process that I just outlined up here for passage, you know, for finding and understanding that passages justify answers gets much more complicated in medicine. And I'll just give you one simple example of this. In addition to all the things I mentioned, here's a question. What antiseptic for the skin has the lowest risk of bacteremia from catheter insertion? And here's a justifying passage. For the prevention of catheter-related central line infections, 2% chlorhexidine and 70% isopropyl is the highest success rate. So, keyword overlap, we have catheter, I think, only, right? Yes. Catheter is the only keyword overlap. Even infection doesn't match because you have to know that that's what bacteremia means. And not only that, even worse than that is the fact that the question is looking for the lowest something and the passage is talking about the highest something. So even if you know enough to know that lowest and highest are opposites, you have to also know that the answer is being expressed in sort of the inverted way that the question is being asked. This never happened to us in Jeopardy. But scientists, as most of us are, we have this really frustrating tendency to write things like this. And it sounds good to us, but it's, boy, is it really hard for the machine to figure out. Okay, so in case you didn't know, we won. Just to remind you, it was very hard, but we did win. We won the Jeopardy challenge. And someone pointed out at the time, and something that I liked, sort of how the progress of computers has been over time. The first major use of computers was to crack the Nazi code in the 40s. Computers were very important in the Apollo mission to put man on the moon. Cell phones came along so that we could talk while we were driving in the car. Finally, some of the biggest computational problems were, you know, rendering the spattering of blood. This is not a joke, actually. There was significant effort spent in a realistic blood splatter. And then Watson came along to win a TV quiz, so you can just sort of see where the y-axis there is plotting this on usefulness and the requirement for computing power. I like this, but of course, you know, we think we did do something productive because you know, the ultimate goal of this was not to create a technology that would win on Jeopardy. The goal of participating on Jeopardy was something that we as scientists had a lot of trouble with at the beginning, I'll tell you, because we really were afraid of this kind of reaction. But I think that the person who did this meant it in fun, and what we thought was really useful about the Jeopardy showcase was that it really drew a lot of attention to problems, these kinds of what IBM is now calling cognitive computing problems, where a lot of people did not take this kind of computing seriously, including people at IBM, and it changed their minds quite rapidly. And so let me just talk about I started with these four pillars of cognitive computing, and so let me just tell you about why Watson led us to the conclusion that these were a new kind of computing. So first and foremost, we developed the system through this continuous cycle of improvement. You know, there were bugs in the traditional sense of bugs, but our primary engineering methodology was to work against a metric and steadily improve the performance of the system against that metric. And so each one of those lines represents these quarterly runs because we had so much question and answer data from the fan websites. We were able to run on brand new data that none of us had ever seen. We literally had a data policeman who was responsible for making sure that no one on the team ever saw the hidden questions, so that we always had a large set of questions that we hadn't seen yet, because we knew we were going to play a game on questions we had not seen yet. And so this represents steady improvement on questions that were never seen. Clearly, you know, the idea of using natural language is for harnessing information that's out there on the web. You know, this is one of the most prevalent problems that you hear every day, that information is, there's too much of it available and no one has the time to sift through it, even when it's critically important to their job or in some cases to their lives. And where we're taking this technology today is helping people understand the flow of information in medicine. You know, the Watson will run on a laptop. It'll answer questions on the laptop. It's just a big Java system, but it takes 2.5 hours to run on a typical laptop. To get the question answering down to 2 seconds required a huge amount of scale, and in any practical situation, you can't expect a system for which really question answering is kind of a subpart of some larger system that part of it's going to take 2 hours to finish. You probably don't need the logo on the front, but you need the big iron there for these kinds of problems. And again, we use natural language here. That was, for us at least, significant to the natural way, not only that people ask questions, but the natural way that people are going to provide information. And this is critical, I think, especially for medicine, where there was a way of thinking that still exists today, and it's not as prevalent as it was about 10 or 20 or 30 years ago, where people believed that ultimately all medical data would be provided in these databases, where everything about medicine would be in structured data. And it's clear, absolutely clear, that the primary way that humans communicate is through natural language, and that's not going to change anytime soon. And so we need to be able to make machines exploit data in that form and not assume that everything's going to be in a database. But again, that's not to say databases aren't useful. It reminds me of this scene in the fourth Star Trek movie where they go back in time to 80s Earth, and Scotty there, chief engineer, if you don't know Star Trek, is shown a 80s computer. It's an old Macintosh. And he sits down in front of it, and he says, "Computer," and nothing happens. And so the guy hands him the mouse, and he says, "Oh, computer." And so I really think that the ways in which we interact with computers today are going to seem sort of antiquated and cute in the future, that the machine will, even touch screens today, I've already grown frustrated with a mouse. I now, because I use a touchscreen on my phone and a tablet, I want my computer to do the same thing. I'm totally off the mouse now. And I think, and this is sort of a personal view, that the social web is just a critical source of a new kind of information that we're really only beginning to understand. There's a really nice paper presented last year at AAAI about predicting the spread of disease just based on people's Twitter posts. And they found that they can beat by months the Center for Disease Control in the prediction of just by people whining about their symptoms on Twitter, which is what it's for. So these are really exciting to me. And the fact that the data is primarily in a kind of a natural language, so it's maybe unnatural, but it's certainly not a computer.
Some caveats, though. Google's flu prediction didn't come out that right.
So. Yes, so it's very fallible, but there's promise here, and there's a kind of data that I think we're just beginning to understand. A lot of current efforts have been focused on the graph itself, and I'm really excited about the possibility of including the language part of it into that kind of analysis. All right, let me stop there. I won't go through all these points, I'll just leave them on the screen and switch to question answering.
So you talked about porting Watson to healthcare data. Have you given consideration to the fact that in healthcare, quite often researchers, their information needs them to be quite complex? And so answers to questions tend to span multiple texts, not just a single phrase. Those cases require sort of aggregating answers, making semantic associations and connections across them. Really what needs to be done is presenting an answer set as opposed to a single answer. Have you given some consideration to...
Yes, so as I was saying, that ultimately for this to be useful, the question answering part of the system sort of becomes a subpart. And in our current architecture for handling this in medicine, what it really produces is a graph of hypothetical questions that you ask, and there's various kinds of computing that happens on this graph. Question answering is only one of them. And so that allows us to span questions, span have answers span texts, and combine them through this graph. And it also serves as a way to integrate some of these more formal graph-like representations of medical.
Very brief technical question. Actually, it's kind of a two-part technical question. The semantic data you were using was not your own. You were not generating these ontologies. You were literally going out to the web to pick these up from other sources, correct?
Yeah, so that was a very important, I think, part of our methodology. We did not grow any of our own structured sources. We needed the problem that you create when you do that for open domain problems is that you don't know how well you're going to do on questions you haven't seen because you've adapted your system, you know, to the needs of the questions that you have seen. So we wanted to have a statistical understanding of, for example, what's the probability that a Jeopardy answer is going to be in Wikipedia, or is going to be in Freebase, and so forth. Understand that without us touching it. We found tons and tons of errors in Freebase, and IMDb, and DBpedia, but we didn't touch them. We left them as they were because they were properties of the source.
So you did break in terms of accuracy of answers, like how reliable IMDb is versus how reliable.
Yeah, so I want to be clear, we did do that, but it's only in the context of Jeopardy. So it's not really a quality indication so much as a suitability. How suitable DBpedia, very suitable for Jeopardy. That's really all we were able to measure.
Okay. And my only other question to that is, how did you guarantee your connection? I've wondered that since the show aired.
Guarantee what?
Guarantee your internet connection.
There was no internet connection.
Oh, there wasn't.
No, it's against the law. And that's not a joke. Game shows in the United States are federally regulated. And you are not allowed to have any outside communication.
So this was all, so you were running Watson all on the learned data?
We were running Watson over a set of sources that included encyclopedias like Wikipedia, Encyclopedia Britannica. We had all of the New York Times back to 1920. Time magazine, but it was all all in memory, ready to go. So we had the sources pre-selected for the show.
So you literally had to copy a segment of the internet?
Not all of it's part of the internet.
I guess I'll follow the technical question with an odd question. Jeopardy is a game, so I imagine that the producers work pretty hard to design the questions so that they have an appearance of being very hard, but that they're answerable enough that you don't have to see this, is that a lot of Jeopardy questions, and one of the questions you show had this feature, the JFK question, a lot of Jeopardy questions have the feature that there's actually multiple ways of getting to the answer from the data they give you. You can throw away 60% of the words and still get the right answer. So there's multiple chains. Now, to what extent does Watson depend on the fact that they give you data that, in some sense, over-specifies the answer? And the reason I'm asking this is because when you go to the medical domain, unless it's Dr. House torturing his residents, I don't think physicians are going to engineer their questions to quite that extent.
So for the machine, it actually makes it harder when you do that. So the problem becomes being able to understand when it's more common that long questions give you information that you don't need. Our favorite example of this was a question from the late 90s. The question was, 80% of American high school students don't know who the vice president is, but they all know this Titanic star. So you don't need, 80% of that question has nothing to do with the answer and is useless information. If you try to if the machine tries to process, it's going to go in the wrong direction, because you're going to get something like Al Gore is going to come up. He was president at the time, vice president at the time. So more of the long questions had that form. And what the machine needs to be able to do is break the question up into parts, recognize when questions come in parts, and then process those parts independently and then try to synthesize the results. And in the cases where the results don't line up, as in that question, this also happened to us in the sort of now famous Toronto question, where again, the different parts of the questions, it didn't work, the machine wasn't able to make them line up. Yeah?
It's probably, in a sense, a related question. I mean, there is no doubt in my mind that IBM Watson, the system, will go into the history of AI as one of the big next steps after Deep Blue, which happened to be also IBM, and previous drivers of development, which often happen to be developed on the basis of games, essentially. Now, if you look at it from that perspective, essentially see the applying AI to solving games and outperforming humans on playing games. And one observation one can make is that it was always extremely difficult to carry over technology used for, say, solving a game like checkers or chess to another game like Go or poker. Different worlds, completely new methods had to be established in order to make the transition. Now, and usually what happened, if I understand all that correctly, was that after a game was solved, the understanding started to kick in why the particular constraints of this game actually made that particular technology possible to solve that game. But that was only understood afterwards when you were trying to transfer the technology. So one question one can ask here is, what are the specific parameters of the Jeopardy game which made your approach work on that? And are there any insights yet on the barrier this might actually build in terms of transferring to other probably non-game questions, like you mentioned medical systems? Would you just rely on what John has been asking? Any insights you want or can share?
No, it worked right out of the box on medical. They're laughing because it's so obviously not the case. So let me argue, push back a little bit. There is commonality between a lot of game playing systems, right? So the Minimax search with alpha beta pruning, I mean, that was used in IBM's Deep Blue. They used perceptron learning to compute the weights and the features and the heuristics, right? So those ideas got transferred over. And now we have Monte Carlo simulation, which is heavily used in, more complex game playing, and which we used in Watson for figuring out what the best bet was during the betting situations. But, yes, of course, you learn about how we're so focused on winning the game, and we had to do a bunch of things that did turn out to be very Jeopardy-specific, some of which we just had to throw away, like all the puzzle-solving stuff. I mean, that was just specific to Jeopardy. Jeopardy has a bunch of puzzle-solving question categories that we had to be able to answer. From a language perspective, we were really, really intent on trying to preserve as much as possible for medicine. One of the biggest things that hit us, the two biggest things that we've found so far in trying to handle is the medicine. One leads to an architectural change that I mentioned, where we consider the question answering system to be embedded in a larger framework, because what made Jeopardy doable at that level of performance was 80% of the time the answers were in a sentence, one sentence. You didn't have to combine information across sentences, as was asked earlier. So you do need to do that for medicine. You just can't avoid it. The answer is never in one sentence. And for the answers that are in one sentence, the doctors don't care about those answers. They know them already. So that was critical for us. We needed to go past this. And the second, on the linguistic side, I sort of mentioned this before, what I'm going to call negation, but I don't mean negation in the logical sense. This way, as I gave an example of scientific writing, tends to write things in a backwards way. There is, in a sense, four ways of saying everything, depending on how many negations you use. And so you can describe a disease, you can describe heart disease and all the variations of heart disease, and you can contrast them. And what you can contrast them by saying, well, this form of heart disease has these 10 symptoms, and this form of heart disease has this 10 symptoms. And you're implying in that list that the ones that I don't list here, you don't have. And in some of them, the absence of a symptom is the difference between these two conditions. Sometimes they say that, sometimes they just leave it out, and you're supposed to assume, oh, it's not there, it must be the only difference. And so that's turning out to be incredibly difficult to account for in our NLP on the NLP side.
So in this case, how about first, especially in medicine, we have, as you said, we have different answers for one question. Is there any way we can at least find the goal of the question at the beginning round? You extract the keywords of the questions and the type core of the questions, and also the goal of the question. At least some hypothesis, maybe that's the goal of the question.
And what's your question?
If you have a goal of the question one round of the we have a question, you pass the keywords of the question or the phrases, you pass the type of questions, and is there any way you also can pass the goal of the question, or at least say maybe this is the goal of the question?
In the medical use, is the objective clearly defined ahead of time?
Yeah, so in for Jeopardy, no. As I said, in a sense, what we realized later was almost all our answers were in a single sentence, and what you were really looking for was a sentence that sort of paraphrased the question. And implicitly, that was the goal. For our medical applications, you get the goal from context, and this can either be explicit, like we're doing diagnosis, so you know. Okay, the task is diagnosis, therefore the goal is to find some condition, disease condition or something like that explains a set of symptoms. And so you know that that's the goal. But the goal may be to find the right treatment, and in that case you know the goal is some kind of treatment that again best satisfies the conditions and the symptoms and so forth. So in this larger framework that includes question answering now as a component, the idea of having knowing when you're done because you've reached a goal state is part of the architecture.
I have a question also. One of the very first example you went through, we had a keyword like drink in the question, and in the answer we have a beverage, right? And that was a problem because you said machine cannot understand at the end because they are like two different words. So why we don't annotate the question at the very first point, annotating the ontology, and then we have the similar.
Because there is no ontology, so one of the things we had to do at the beginning was commit to the fact that there would not be one ontology. We use as many ontologies as we can find, and we consider each of them evidence for. Because we don't have controlled language to work from. Wikipedia is not written in a controlled language that obeys the constraints of ontology X, Y, or Z. So what we use existing ontologies for is evidence that someone thinks that, this particular term matches this particular class. And everything has names, and that's how we try to line the evidence up. So I can tell you that in the system that we had before we began the Jeopardy project, it did have an ontology, and that was the problem. The ontology accounted for less than a third of natural language utterances, and as a result of that, we could never get more than a third of the questions right. We were completely limited by the assumption that the question would get mapped into the ontology. So we threw that assumption away.
But if we classify the questions and then maybe go with the ontology related to that kind of questions.
So you could have a very coarse-grained ontology of question classes, which is something we did do, but it's a different sense of ontology here. It's that there are questions that, you know, we had puzzle questions, we had definition questions where you're given a definition and you have to have the word. I mean, that was the level of ontology that we had for questions. But we didn't have an ontology that had person, facility, event in it. You know, that we used such ontologies, but we didn't prescribe them. We used them in a post hoc way to gather events.
Maybe that worked better for biomedical area.
We're finding that is exactly the same for biomedicine.
For the regular, for the Jeopardy area, you kind of dismiss the logical representation of the sentence, and I assume that you do the same thing for the biomedical area.
It's certainly the case that it's playing a larger role, but again, we're just pushing in an incremental way out from the minimal kinds of stuff we did for Jeopardy.
It's kind of going in that direction with the question goal. In Jeopardy, you kind of corroborated your understanding of the question by looking for the answer in the text, right? By kind of rewriting the question with the answer, and that gave you an indication, or was one of the ways to give you an indication that you understood the question correctly. But if an answer cannot be easily given, that steps kind of out for you in the biomedical field. So just for human
yes.
verification, like the logical representation would probably help. To see if the system understood the question properly.
Yeah, so because of the way Watson works, that doesn't help you because it's what it's computing, it never really knows if it understood the question. What it knows is if it was able to match passage to the question.
Right.
Which may or may not mean it understood it. It may mean it misunderstood it, but the fact that it found a match is the only way it knows what understanding is. That's its understanding.
Which works in the simple answer cases, right? But as Darrow said, we have long answers to a question that may not even match the question anymore, right? Syntactically.
This isn't only a property of giving of questions that have short answers. This basic core idea of passage matching is still the basic core idea in Watson, that we're trying to find relevant pieces of information in text by matching them to whatever the information description is, whether it's a question or an entire patient record, you know, whatever it happens to be, we're still doing that matching. In the case where the information specification, which is the generalized version of a question, is much more complex, you need intelligent ways to decompose it so that the passage matching has a chance of succeeding at this more micro, fine-grained level, but it's still the core of the system is that passage matching. Passage matching.
So as far as the UI for healthcare is concerned, is that a web-based thing, or is it semantic?
The UI for what?
For in healthcare, to use Watson. How am I speaking to Watson?
So it's still a research project. There's no UI. We're still trying to understand, you know, the system doesn't interact with people just yet.
And another question would be, well, I read right after the Japanese challenge about the plan for healthcare was to deploy systems that rack at like a hospital, for instance. Is that still the plan, or is it maybe more centralized because it's a large cluster, obviously, that doesn't match well with the hospital?
Well, hospitals have plenty of room for computing power, but you just kick a couple poor people out of the cheap rooms. No, I'm kidding. I'm in the research division, and what I described to you are the plans for the research group. We want to go deeper into understanding medical language, but there is, as a result of this, IBM did create a commercial division devoted to sort of applying Watson technologies to real business problems. And, you know, each one of those customized solutions is going to have different computing needs. And I really don't know how they're being addressed at all. I don't know. They have their job. Yeah.
How big was your Watson team, and what disciplines were represented?
So the team started out as 12 people. We were mostly, most of the team had a language background, either computational linguistics or computer science, natural language processing. We had one pure linguist. I didn't come from a natural language processing background. Mine was more knowledge representation and databases. We had a bunch of software engineers on the team. Once we started making scientific progress on the problem according to that metric, we also put a team of 5 engineers on for getting the speed of the system down to 2 seconds. The team grew to about 30 by the time we were on the air, including a couple user interface people. We had 3 machine learning people with a strong machine learning background. And now we hired three people with medical and bioinformatics backgrounds to help with the biomedical domain. Yeah?
Are you planning to, for the healthcare application, are you planning to use information shared on social media like Twitter?
Not currently. The healthcare application is going to be pretty focused on patient records. Decision support. But still, the exact what the application would be is not necessarily important here. It's really we're trying to solve some of the more fundamental underlying problems that any of these systems, like a decision-making system, would need solved in order to be possible.
The questions that matter most to me are things like not questions about facts, but more questions about what should I do? Will I be happier if I buy the Taurus or the Aveo, or will my patient do better if I give him tetracycline or amoxicillin? How can Watson deal with that, or is it just mainly a fact finding?
So the technology we developed for Jeopardy is purely fact finding. The idea is really that if you believe most knowledge is expressed in English or a natural language, then this is how you're going to find that knowledge. It would, for a system like a recommender system, it would need more information about you. It would need to be able to combine information from structured sources in ways differently than we combined it for understanding language. So again, all of the research we're doing is ultimately to create a set of technologies that can be used along with other things to solve those kinds of problems. Our technology is the part that's going to help you get the knowledge out of the stuff that's represented in language.
And where do you get the questions for the healthcare domain? Have you got a lot of Q&A?
Yeah, there's plenty of tests, and right now we're sort of focused at that level. There's lots of different test questions that the people were willing to give us and for processing electronic health records. You have discharge reports, for example, from hospitals that could be linked to the patient records, so you can sort of take the discharge report away and say, okay, what's the diagnosis or treatment, and then put it back and see if that's what it was. Of course, that assumes the doctors were correct, but that's a starting place. Yes.
So you say assumption that the quality of sources you have in the medical domain quite high?
How do we, or are?
No, are you assuming that the quality of sources for the medical?
Yeah, so for Jeopardy, we were able to do that mostly automatically because we had so many questions and answers, so we were able to kind of dynamically configure sets of background information to see which gave us the most right answers. We don't have quite as much of that kind of data here, so we are relying on, we have lots of medical students that do short internships with us. We're collaborating with the Cleveland Clinic. We have a collaboration with the Columbia Presbyterian Hospital, which is close by us. So we're using their knowledge of what sources are going to be reliable here to make that selection now.
One more question.
Go ahead.
Do you have some kind of statistics on what features helped you grow your precision in terms of you spoke about?